GMD Media presents an unabridged recording of Money Made Easy by Allison Baggerly, narrated by Marguerite Gavin. Preface. I'm guessing you grabbed this book because you feel stuck with your money. Maybe your parents never taught you how to manage money properly because they were trying to figure it out along the way. Chances are you didn't learn about personal finances in school either. Fast forward to today, and here you are, listening to this book, knowing deep down you want to be better with your money. You want to be able to pay off debt, take a family vacation, and save for retirement. You don't want your stomach to drop every time your beloved dog has an unexpected vet visit or your electricity bill is higher than you had anticipated. Ultimately, you want peace of mind when it comes to your money. You want the freedom that managing your money well offers you. I get it. And I've been there before. Years ago, I stood exactly where you are, listening to a book, searching for answers. I wanted to know how I could change my money habits so I didn't feel stuck all the time. To be honest, I didn't ever think I'd end up here, writing a book about how to make money easy, mostly because money wasn't easy for me. I made a lot of mistakes with money, some of which you'll learn about listening to this book. But I also learned a lot of lessons. Lessons that taught me how I could have a positive relationship with my money and my budget, and love my life in the process. This book will offer you a step-by-step system to make money easy once and for all. You will be encouraged to look at your money through a completely different lens than before. You'll be challenged to question what society tells you is right about money, and set goals that motivate you to make amazing financial progress. No matter where you stand with money, this book is for you. The stories within these pages will inspire you, and the information will help you change your relationship with money for good. This is just the beginning. Chapter 1. Finding Your Catalyst. I sat at the kitchen table with my head in my hands. Tears streamed down my face as my husband and I were hit with the reality of how far out of control our finances were. We had just found out we were unexpectedly pregnant a few weeks after getting married. After completing some simple math, we realized we would not be able to afford monthly daycare payments. My husband and I totaled up exactly how much debt we had. $111,108.29, not including our mortgage. Our minimum monthly payments totaled over $1,400 each month. I did a double take. Surely we had made a mistake when adding all of our debt into the calculator. For two teachers, this might as well have been a fortune. What were we going to do? How would we pay for childcare? Don't kids eat a lot? How would we afford groceries? And, oh my goodness, don't hospitals cost a fortune? Anxiety and fear clouded my mind. I couldn't think straight. I just wanted to pretend that we didn't have a problem. I wanted to go back to when we thought everything was perfectly fine. I wanted to believe our money wasn't an issue. That day at the kitchen table in our small apartment sat two 20-something adults who had no clue how to pull themselves out of the mess they had created. I felt like we were standing at the bottom of a mountain and had no idea how to climb to the top. We didn't have a path to take, a map to follow, or the tools to get there. That moment was our breaking point, our rock bottom. To be honest, my spending habits were downright embarrassing and completely unhealthy. My husband, the saver in our marriage, let me spend money because he thought it would bring me joy. Happy wife, happy life, they say. Unfortunately, my temporary happiness from buying stuff I could not actually afford was setting us up for a world of pain and debt. and our previous choices about taking out massive amounts of student loans left these two school teachers feeling completely hopeless. Teachers are underpaid, overworked, and usually have to supplement their income in some way. I almost resigned myself to the idea that I'd always be waiting on my next paycheck and never be able to go on a nice vacation or live in abundance. My immediate thought was that we would forever feel trapped and suffocated by debt and money. I figured we would never have enough. Enough money, enough freedom, enough peace of mind. But then a little voice in the back of my head whispered something. It said, "What if it doesn't have to be this way? What if two teachers can defy the odds?" Beginning the journey. I didn't know how we were going to get out of debt, live on less money, and fix the financial situation we found ourselves in. We had years of bad spending habits and mindset issues to unpack, but I knew I could figure it out along the way because I was motivated to live a different life than where we found ourselves. My husband, Matt, and I both knew that it would take work to pull ourselves out of the crippling debt on two teacher salaries. I wish I could tell you that we would have made this choice, even if we didn't find ourselves pregnant just a few weeks after getting married. In a perfect world, Matt and I would have made this decision because we wanted it for ourselves as a couple. But I can't tell you that because it would be a lie. We decided to completely change our financial situation because we had to do something different. We took this step to get our money under control for our baby to be. The baby that we didn't even know we wanted. The son that caught us off guard, forced us to take a long look at our life, and do something uncomfortable for someone else. We had to put him first. He was our motivation. He was our catalyst. Evan, our precious boy, was our driving force to sacrifice in areas of our lives for a period of time, so that we could live in abundance for the rest of our life. Yet as we continued on our financial journey, our catalyst became even greater than just our son. We wanted it not just for him and our second son, James. We wanted it for us. We wanted to reach financial success, pay off debt, and be a story that could motivate others. Our journey began out of desperation. Yet as time went on, it turned into a journey that would create a generational shift for our family. That day, while sitting at my hand-me-down kitchen table surrounded by wobbly IKEA kitchen chairs, I wiped my tears away and decided that this was the moment our lives would change. Matt and I jumped with 2 feet into the unknown world of managing our money. We had zero knowledge of what we were doing. They don't teach this stuff in school, but we knew we could figure it out as we went. We just had to start. Matt and I eventually paid off over $111,000 of debt on two teacher salaries. During our almost 5-year journey of paying off debt, we made more mistakes than I care to admit. We weren't perfect. We had moments where we wanted to give up. We were faced with unexpected expenses that set us back months at a time. But after a journey that felt like an eternity, we did it. Matt and I worked together to create a strong foundation for managing our money. And for the rest of our lives, we will reap the rewards of building that foundation. I learned how to conquer impulse spending, how to write a budget that actually works, and what to do when I trip and fall along the way. We created our own money management system that worked, and it's the one we still use to this day. The memory of feeling defeated and hitting rock bottom is just that, a memory. It's no longer our financial truth. But I know rock bottom might be your current reality. I know you might be struggling just to keep up with your expenses. You might be hurting and feeling defeated because you have more bills than money coming in. Maybe you feel like a failure with your finances or completely out of control with money. The shame and guilt might keep you up at night. If that's you, Please know you don't have to live in this space forever. You can pick yourself up, defeat the odds, and change your finances. You are capable of more than you likely give yourself credit for. It will take work, but I promise you that it will be worth it. The catalyst is your motivator for change. The first step, and arguably the most important step, is to find a catalyst to change your money situation that is so strong you won't give up along the way. Managing your money better, paying off debt, and saying no to impulse purchases takes an enormous amount of discipline. It likely takes more discipline than you're used to. We live in a world that tells us to spend more, put purchases on a credit card, and find happiness from stuff. Society tells us that we shouldn't have to wait for anything. Do you want new furniture? Finance it. Want to trade in your current car? Just roll it into your next car payment. Can't afford that beach vacation? That's what credit cards are for. Many people lack the patience to save up for large purchases and eventually find themselves buried in debt. It's easy to get caught up in the exhilaration of buying something new just for the thrill of it. This temporary happiness is present for a moment. But when the excitement of a new item wears off, we are left with the same feelings as before. I say all this from experience. The first time I bought an adult car, it was partly out of necessity. I had a baby on the way, and my car at the time was a two-door Chevy Cavalier with a junk title. I didn't feel comfortable driving around with my newborn son in a car that had been totaled before. I'll never forget taking my new car out for a test drive. It had a sunroof, leather interior, and automatic windows. I had never had a car with automatic windows before. Oh, the luxury. It even had the number one item on my wish list, a CD player. When I test drove that pre-owned Toyota Camry, I felt on top of the world. Side note, I realize how lame this sounds as I type it out. However, this was the nicest car I had ever driven, had features my previous car never had, and is my truth, so I'm going to own it. I remember driving away from the dealership, breathing in the smell of the leather seats and thinking, this car has made me so happy. I'll never get over this feeling. What I didn't know then that I know now, feelings from material possessions fade. My car brought me temporary joy and happiness. To think I would never get over the happiness of a car, just an item in my life, was short-sighted to say the least. I know that now. Yet the world tries to tell us that spending money is the key to happiness. So many people fall for it, myself included. We spend money emotionally to run away from our feelings or provide the thrill we've been missing. It's a constant battle, and one that most people don't even realize they are facing. Breaking free from what the world tells us we should do isn't easy. It takes a great motivator, or as I like to call it, a catalyst for change. A catalyst is your reason for changing the way you spend and manage your money. It's the reason you will sacrifice for a period of time so you can live in abundance the rest of your life. Your catalyst will keep you moving forward when others tell you to give up. It will help you stay motivated when you question why you are working to become debt-free or live on less than you make. It will be your strength when the world tells you that spending money is the key to happiness. It is your North Star, guiding light, and ultimate motivator. Identifying your catalyst for change. When my husband and I started our money journey in 2012, our catalyst was our first son, Evan. His presence was unexpected and turned our world upside down. We had plans for our marriage, but having a child in the first year of marriage wasn't in our plans. Evan led us to look at our lives, money, and future through an entirely different lens than we had before. We knew that if we wanted to pay off debt, build wealth, and offer our children a certain life, we would have to make sacrifices in the present moment. How do you determine your own catalyst for change? How do you find a catalyst that will be strong enough to stand up against society and years of money habits that leave you wanting to spend money? How do you find the thing that will be stronger than your emotional desire to go into deep debt for the car you've always wanted? How do you find a motivator that will last the length of your journey, especially if you'll be working on changing your finances for years on end, like we were? You might have no idea what your catalyst for changing your financial situation should be. It might take you time to determine your own catalyst. You might have to think through your future, goals, and dreams. Journaling and asking yourself hard questions can sometimes help you uncover the catalyst that will carry you through your financial journey. On the other hand, your catalyst might already be staring you in the face and be clear as day. Sometimes your catalyst is found when you've hit your rock bottom moments. It reveals itself when you're at the end of your rope, stressed, overwhelmed, and aware that something has to change. It's sitting there next to you when you have your head in your hands, tears streaming down your face. And there's a deep knowing that you want something different for yourself and your family. It's in these rock-bottom moments that our catalyst appears and becomes the driving force for a different life. It becomes our reason for picking ourselves back up, dusting ourselves off, and committing to doing something different with our money. My family's catalyst revealed itself in our own rock-bottom moment. While this was difficult to realize, it was enough of a driving force to stay committed to our financial journey for years on end. It was strong enough for us to change our money habits, face our financial truth, and prioritize our needs over our wants. Your catalyst for change might lie in the seemingly small, annoying, and frustrating moments that add up over time. Moments such as having your debit card declined at the grocery store, or realizing you've been hit with yet another overdraft fee. Your catalyst might reveal itself to you in the arguments you have with your spouse about money, or the feeling of dread as you open the mailbox and see yet another bill you have to pay. Your catalyst could stem from the sleepless nights where you worry about your finances. Or maybe it's the desire to simply take a vacation every year without going into debt. These small moments add up over time to create a catalyst for you, the desire for control and confidence with money. Your catalyst for change could also be a person. Maybe that person is you. You are a worthy reason to change your finances and manage your money better. Maybe that person is your child, or even a niece or nephew. Your catalyst could even be your parents. I've known people who witnessed their parents stress about money and saw firsthand what happens when you hit retirement with little money saved. The burden fell on the children. While this person loved their parents with all their heart, they wanted a different life than what was modeled for them. Their catalyst was generational change. Whatever it is, your catalyst must be strong enough to carry you through this journey to managing your money better, living on a budget, and paying off debt even when it becomes an inconvenience. It must be bigger than the desire to succumb to what the world tells you about money. Your catalyst needs to be in the forefront of your mind and be greater than the frustrations you might face along the way. Before you move forward on your financial journey, I want you to determine your catalyst for change. Take a moment to think about why you are listening to this book. Why do you want to budget better or start budgeting altogether? What makes you want to become debt-free and save money? The ultimate goal is to dig deep enough to find a reason that will hold strong through the temptation to overspend, go into debt, or give up on your money journey. While you'll never be perfect, your catalyst will be the reason why you stand up after you fall. Decide to budget even when you don't feel like it, and slowly make changes with your money. Use the Catalyst for Change worksheet, found in the PDF that accompanies this audiobook, to help identify your own catalyst for change. You can use the one provided or download the worksheet from www.inspiredbudget.com/moneymadeeasy. Real world examples. Over the years, I have had the joy of hearing from hundreds of people about their driving forces for change. People come to me when they've hit their rock bottom moments or are fed up with their financial situation. They come to me when they desperately need a catalyst for change. I've helped guide others to find their own driving force for change. Here's a list of common catalysts that many people have set as their motivator to take back control of their money, spending, and debt. Catalyst: my future family. Desired change: someone wants to have a child but has health concerns that might affect their ability to safely carry a child. They want to become debt-free so they can afford adoption or a gestational carrier. Catalyst: my current family. Desired change: someone wants to be a stay-at-home mom, but can't do that unless they pay off debt and reduce monthly payments. Catalyst: generational wealth. Desired change: a person has seen their parents live paycheck to paycheck their entire life and wants to break this cycle for future generations. Their goal is to create wealth for generations to come. Catalyst: rewrite family history. Desired change: someone has experienced how debt and money stress affected their parents. They want to rewrite their family history and have the freedom that becoming debt-free offers. Catalyst: myself. Desired change: someone wants to put themselves and their future first. They want to let go of their past money choices. Paying off debt, saving, and investing is a form of healing for this person. Catalyst: a job I love. Desired change: someone wants to escape a career that they don't love. They want the freedom to leave their job and know that they are secure financially. Catalyst: my child. Desired change: someone wants their son or daughter to see what financial security looks like. They want to be a model for what it means to be financially successful. Catalyst: a better life. Desired change: someone wants a better life than what was modeled for them. They want to break free from any harmful money habits, not just for their family, but for themselves as well. No matter what your catalyst may be, hold it close to your heart. It will be the driving force that will get you started and keep you motivated as you learn how to manage your money better. In the beginning, your catalyst will likely be the only thing keeping you focused and moving forward. Yet as time passes on, you'll have to rely less and less on your catalyst to keep you motivated. Instead, you will have developed helpful money habits that make sticking to your plan easier. This simple fact caught me off guard during our journey. Creating internal motivation. When Matt and I first started budgeting, I hated the idea of writing a budget. The entire process felt forced, frustrating, and left me feeling deprived. I figured I would only write a budget until we were debt-free. I daydreamed about walking into Target, which I lovingly refer to as the motherland, and filling my cart to the brim with items I wanted, but did not need. I would shop until my heart was happy and the trunk of my car was full. No budget would keep me from spending my money how I wanted. I vowed that once we became debt-free, I would be done with budgets forever. Clearly, the joke was on me because now I'm writing a book about budgeting. Little did I know that as time went on, I no longer needed to rely on my catalyst to motivate me. Budgeting and managing my money better were no longer simply tasks I completed. It was no longer something I did each day, week, or month. Thinking through my spending was no longer something I had to remind myself to do. In fact, I actually looked forward to budgeting each month. Who was I and what had I done with past Allison? The idea of writing a budget, tracking my expenses, and making a plan for my money gave me a new confidence and feeling of security I had never had before. Budgeting and taking control over my finances had become part of my identity. I wasn't just budgeting each month. I was a budgeter. I wasn't just checking off boxes on a list to have control over my money. Instead, managing our finances became part of who I was. I looked forward to payday so I could move money to savings, pay off debt, and take one step closer to our money goals. Over time, my money habits naturally changed. I no longer had to force myself to think about money in a better light. It all came more naturally to me. It was in that moment I realized I no longer needed my catalyst, our children, to motivate me, while they were, and still are, great motivators for living a better life. I had the motivation within me now. It's a part of who I am. I have the internal motivation to continue handling my money in a positive way, instead of relying on an external motivator. You'll be able to experience this as well. As time goes on, and as you continue to make small decisions each day about your money, you will develop the internal motivation you need to keep going. You will no longer rely on the catalyst that got you started at the beginning. Your money habits and thinking will change. This takes time. It took years for me to realize this, but it's an amazing place to be. Now it's your turn. Take a moment to think through your catalyst for change. Before you do anything to improve your money or financial situation, what is the thing that will keep you motivated when you get started? What is the catalyst that will keep you working on your money when you would rather spend it on something that caught your eye? What's the catalyst that will keep you from picking up dinner after a long day at work when you know you have food at home? Your catalyst for change will be what you turn to when you want to give up. Life gets hard, you're hit with an unexpected expense, or you're just tired of making adult choices with your money. It's your reason to keep moving forward each and every day. Keep it at the forefront of your mind from this point on. Action items. Take time to think and journal about the following questions to help you define your catalyst for change. Why do you want to budget better or start budgeting altogether? What could you accomplish or do if you no longer had debt payments? What dreams do you have for your future? Who do you want to live a different life for? It could be yourself or a family member. How does your current financial state make you feel? If money was not an issue in your life, how would you spend your days? What would you do? If money was not an issue in your life, how would you feel? Complete the following sentence. My catalyst for changing my financial situation is... Chapter 2. Money Habits and Money Mindset. I slammed the front door with all my might and headed straight for my car. My husband, Matt, and I had just had a huge fight. I was seething with anger, and every part of me needed to escape my apartment, or else I would say something I would later regret. I desperately needed to find space to clear my mind and be in my happy place. It was 10 p.m., and I knew exactly where I was headed. Kohl's. Kohl's is a department store that carries it all. Clothing for all ages, jewelry, handbags, as well as home and bath goods. The reason I chose Kohl's as my safe haven came down to its late hours. Kohl's is open until at least 11 p.m. every night. I opened the heavy glass door and immediately felt a sense of calm and peace rush over me. I shopped at Kohl's until it closed, drove home, and I was no longer angry with my husband. Once again, Kohl's had come through, and I was happy and at peace again. Problem solved. Simply put, shopping brought me joy. I realize now that this should have been a major red flag for me, but I was blind to it at the time. All I knew was that my blood was boiling at one moment, and the next it was not. That's all that mattered. I didn't realize it then, but looking back, I know I was using shopping as an escape mechanism. Instead of facing my fears, anger, or frustrations head on, I shopped. Instead of allowing myself room to be sad, I shopped. Instead of having hard conversations and dealing with the problem, I shopped. Over the years, spending money had turned into a way for me to escape difficult emotions and even celebrate or enhance positive emotions. This unhealthy pattern solidified itself years earlier when I was in college and had the freedom I had always wanted. I had student loan money burning a hole in my bank account, and I was eager to spend it on anything and everything other than college. With my newfound freedom, my emotional shopping took a turn for the worse. I would spend money not just when I was sad, but when I was happy, bored, excited, angry, and every emotion in between. On the one hand, I used shopping and spending money as a reward. Got a good grade on a test, get a pedicure. Made the student organization I had applied for, head to the mall. Worked out 4 times in a week, celebrate with a new outfit. Spending money became a default habit for me when I was happy, excited, or proud of my work in college. On the other hand, I also used shopping and spending money to cope with sadness, depression, or any unwanted emotions. Each time I bought a new item this way, I was solidifying a very harmful money belief deep inside me. I can control my emotions and life by spending money. Years of childhood experiences related to money and later my adult experiences with money had led to incredibly harmful financial habits and money mindsets that were tough to break. Money mindset. What is it? Your money mindset is your overall outlook on and beliefs about money. Like it or not, the way you view money today is based on a series of assumptions and deeply held beliefs that you've had for years. Many of these beliefs likely stem from your childhood and early adult years. But what if you no longer want to see money or your finances as you always have? What if you realize now that your current view on money and finances is actually holding you back from the goals you want to reach? What if you want to completely change your outlook on your income, spending, and ability to build wealth? Are you out of luck and stuck with the assumptions you've always had? Gosh, I hope you don't believe that. I know as a matter of fact that you can change those assumptions. Not enough people challenge their own money mindset, so they miss out on the opportunity to improve their financial situation. In fact, many people aren't fully aware of their money mindset or how it affects both their present and future. Many people might not challenge their money mindset because they didn't realize they could challenge and change it. I was one of those people. It took time for me to realize that my mindset, and yours too, is a powerful thing. Better yet, we are in control of what we believe. Challenging your money mindset and creating positive money habits isn't only a starting point. It shapes your entire thought process on important matters, from career choices to politics and, of course, money. The way we budget, the way we spend, all the investments we make, and how we respond to money stem from our money mindset. Every aspect of our approach to money has one thing in common. That's our money mindset. Your money mindset has influenced your current financial situation. It's the same mindset that slowly started forming during childhood and continued into your adult life. To truly understand your money mindset, you must first look back to how money affected your early years. Your childhood and money. A lot of people don't realize this, but the way your parents or guardians talked about finances has likely had a significant impact on your money mindset.
It doesn't matter if your parents had a healthy relationship with money or a tumultuous relationship with it. Even if you never heard your parents discuss money because it was considered rude or inappropriate to discuss finances in front of children, it still had a major impact on how you view money. Many times, children form a money mindset by simply observing their parents, even when they didn't realize they were watching them. Children pick up on small conversations or tense moments in the home. They listen to what's going on and ask themselves if everything is okay. As a child, you formed a belief about money that was passed down to you by your parents and even your parents' parents. The person who witnessed their parents fighting about money on a weekly or monthly basis likely grew up believing money is scarce, causes conflict, and can even tear a family apart. The person who grew up with a father who controlled the finances and didn't let his partner have a say in how money was spent most likely grew up believing men should handle the money and women should not have a say in the matter. The person who grew up with parents who worked multiple jobs and sacrificed everything just to keep food on the table likely grew up believing no matter how hard they work, they will always struggle financially. However, there are times when children make assumptions or form beliefs about their parents and money that aren't necessarily true. Maybe you thought your parents divorced over money, but there was a deeper reason for the divorce that you couldn't understand as a child. No matter what, your perception as a child is your reality. Let that sink in for a bit. As a child, if your perception was that money causes arguments or divorce, that was your reality regardless of whether or not money was actually the cause of stress in your childhood home. Whatever you perceived as a child was your reality until a parent sat down and explained what was really going on in the home. And the perception you have about money from your childhood carries into adulthood. If you want to move forward and change the way you interact with money, it's important to identify how your childhood influenced your view on money. It can be painful to open up the door to your childhood, especially if it holds trauma that you haven't worked through yet. But do you want to know the good news about this process? Once you understand what your childhood taught you about money, you have a very important choice to make. You get to decide if you want to keep or let go of what you learned about money from your childhood. You don't have to stand by what your parents or childhood experiences taught you about money. You can change your outlook and mindset about money to serve you better. However, before you do that, you might have to forgive your parents for not teaching you more about how to manage money as an adult. Over the years, I've worked with many couples and individuals when it comes to their money. One pattern I've noticed is adults, mainly millennials, are frustrated that their parents and school system didn't teach them about managing money or budgeting earlier on in life. It's easy to think, I would have been better off financially had my parents taught me basic financial concepts when I was younger. I've even thought this myself. I remember feeling like I had missed a secret money class in high school where everyone else received valuable life information except me. Why didn't my counselor sign me up for this class? However, years after working on my own money mindset, I had a very big realization. Our parents, mine, yours, and almost everyone else's, weren't withholding grand information from their children. They weren't planning to push us out into the world and have us figure it all out on our own. Your parents weren't hiding knowledge and hoping you would stumble upon the right books to teach you how to manage money properly. They, too, were in the midst of learning how to manage their own money. In fact, learning how to manage your money Write a budget, save, and invest before the internet was available was a privilege. Before the internet, adults only had two ways to learn about finances. One option was to have access to a guide. Essentially, this was a person in your life that would have the time, patience, and ability to sit down with you and teach you how to manage money properly. This means your parents had to have had access to this person in their family or community. Sometimes this person didn't exist or wasn't available in the community. The second option was to know how to gather financial information on their own. That means our parents would need to know how to read, check out a library book, and know which books to read in order to learn this information. Just knowing how to gather information and consume it in English is also a privilege that many people didn't have. Learning about money and personal finance was a privilege before the internet, and it still is to this day. Chances are, if your parents didn't teach you about managing money or the importance of paying credit cards on time, it was likely because they were trying to figure it out while you were a child. How could they teach their children about a concept or way of living that they were still trying to figure out on their own? You might be frustrated with your parents for the example they set with money. You might be annoyed that they didn't talk about money with you or teach you how to handle your finances properly. But once you realize that your parents did the best they could with what they knew at the time, you can let go of that frustration and replace it with grace instead. Here is the truth. We are all doing the best we can with what we know at the time. We won't always get it right. We all make mistakes along the way. We won't be perfect. All that matters is that you're willing to own up to your past choices and make the effort to learn and do better for your future. I, for one, am happy to extend this grace to my parents in hopes that my own children will do the same for me one day. Take this moment to also extend grace to yourself. You might be frustrated with your past money choices. Remember this simple fact. You did the best you could with what you knew at the time. The good news is that you're here now learning more about how to manage your money easily. Let go of those past money choices you made, and let's focus on your amazing future. Thankfully, you and I are not in the same boat our parents were in. We live in a world where we have easy access to the internet, social media, and content creators that are willing to share their knowledge and guide you along on your own money journey. The first step to changing your money mindset into one that serves you is by identifying how money in your early years has influenced the way you see and interact with money now. Take a moment to answer the following questions. Did you hear your parents discuss money at home? Did your parents fight about money? If so, how did that affect the way you saw money as a child? Did money feel scarce in your childhood home? Was money a conversation topic you could openly talk about at home? What was your most positive money memory from your childhood? What was your most negative money memory from your childhood? Do you think this memory has affected you as an adult? Is there a pattern in how you felt about money as a child and how you feel about money now? Once you've identified how your childhood influenced your money mindset, it's time to decide whether what you learned from your money story in those early years is serving you today. Do you want to carry the money beliefs that you've held for years? If the answer is yes, then great. You're on the right path. If the answer is no, then that's okay too. You can let go of these beliefs and develop your own set of beliefs from this moment forward. That's the wonderful part. You have a choice in this. Scarcity versus abundance money mindset. I was at recess watching my fourth grade students play one spring day when another teacher walked over to where I was standing. He told me he had heard my husband and I were trying to pay off our student loans. By this point in our journey, I was very vocal about our goals and our mission. My husband and I were fired up and excited to become two debt-free teachers. This man was a teacher in our school, and so was his wife. They were both about 15 years older than my husband and me. Because we appeared to have so much in common, he thought it was appropriate to share his own opinion about our goals. I hear you a matter trying to pay off debt, even your student loans, he said with a big smile. Yes, we have a big goal we are trying to reach, I replied. I'll never forget his next words because they cut so close to home. Good luck with that. You'll always have debt because you're just two teachers. He gave a small laugh, put his hands in his pockets, and walked away. I was shocked. I couldn't find any words. I stood at the playground speechless, wondering how he knew one of my deepest fears and insecurities. How did he know what I had once believed to be true? His words mirrored the thoughts I held before we started our debt-free journey. These were the exact words I told myself that fateful night while sitting at the kitchen table with my husband. I'll always have debt because we are just two teachers. I believed we would never become debt-free on two teachers' salaries. I believed we would never build wealth as two teachers. I believed we were destined for the paycheck-to-paycheck life because of our jobs. I sat in silence and shock until a new thought emerged, one that would have never revealed itself years prior. Just because you still have student loans doesn't mean I have to. Just because you are a teacher and have debt doesn't mean that's my future. Just because this is your reality doesn't make it mine. That was the first time someone openly questioned our family's personal money choices. It was the first time someone thought they could blatantly force their scarcity mindset about money on me. Yet it was also the first time I thought, just watch me. I know what I'm capable of. Just because you may not have a high-paying job doesn't mean you can't reach your money goals. You are capable of becoming debt-free. You are capable of investing, building wealth, and living a different life from the one the world paints for you. It all starts with one step in the right direction. To the fellow teacher who laughed at me that day, you were wrong. His scarcity mindset was rearing its ugly head that day, and he attempted to force that mindset on me. What he didn't know was that I had already done the work to let go of my scarcity money mindset and create an abundance money mindset. Thank goodness I had done the work on myself, or else I may have believed the money lies he was telling me. A scarcity mindset is the belief that there will never be enough of something. When applied to money, a scarcity mindset can manifest itself in several ways. It leads us to believe money lies that we need to unpack. Someone with a scarcity money mindset thinks, I'll never make enough money. There is not enough money in the world for me. I'll always struggle financially. I have to buy this item I want now because I'll never be able to afford it in the future. A teacher, even a dual-income household of two teachers, can never become debt-free. An abundance mindset is the complete opposite. When you have this mindset, you believe that there is enough of everything for everyone. If you have an abundance money mindset, you think, there's more than enough money in the world for me. I can buy this item later because money will come to me. There will always be enough money to meet my goals. I can become debt-free no matter my profession, even if I'm just a teacher. So how do you replace a scarcity mindset with an abundance mindset when it comes to your money? It all comes down to identifying the money lies we believe and how we react to our money. Rewriting this thought process will take time. But doesn't it make sense that this would take time? You've been thinking one way for a very long time, so naturally it will take time and effort to rewrite those thoughts. If you've had a scarcity mindset about money, chances are it's been forming for years on end. However, you are the gatekeeper to your mindset, and you can shift your mindset at any time. Stop believing money lies. It's self-determination, discipline, and the right mental approach to money that drives even the most economically challenged to overcome odds and build wealth that will last generations. Your money mindset can drive you forward or drag you back. You've had money thoughts and beliefs for years. But if these thoughts are no longer serving you, then it's time to completely rewrite these thoughts. Your scarcity money thoughts are essentially money lies that you are telling yourself. I turn to social media to ask my followers and community to share the money lies they've believed in the past or present. I was amazed to read their responses. Here are just a handful of them. Budgets are limiting. I can't enjoy my life on a budget. Investing is for rich people. I don't make a lot of money, so I'll always be broke. I'll start budgeting when I make more money. I'm too old to save for retirement. I started too late. I'm bad with money, so why bother trying to manage it? I was raised poor, so that is my future. I'll never save enough for retirement, so I'll have to work forever. I owe too much to ever get out of debt. These money lies are usually based on emotions, past experiences, and our own limited mindset. They are easy to believe because you've likely believed them for years on end. But once you recognize these thoughts as lies, you can completely change them. It all comes down to questioning the money thoughts that enter your mind. This practice takes time, and the more you practice, the easier it will become. When a scarcity money thought, or money lie, enters your mind, ask yourself these five questions. 1. Is this money thought true?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.